there towards the end of that, and it was no accident that that little guitar riff was added to the end of the song. Why would we start out with this riff? Well, give me just a second, I'll explain why. That song is perhaps one of the most recognizable songs around this world, specifically probably in gyms and athletic situations, if I'm not mistaken, Coach Darren. It's played just about everywhere. All you need are the first couple of seconds of that intro to know the name of the song. Somebody throw it out there. There you go. Done. See what I'm talking about. Anybody know who did the song back in the day? Ooh. I heard it. Who said it? Come on, Joel. Own it. Yes. Survivor was the group that did the movie. Now, can you tell me what movie the song was produced for and made it popular? Rocky. Not two. Close. Three. There you go. We're going back into some of this older culture, if you will. I was surprised to see that that movie first came out in 1982 was shocked. Anyway, just kind of had an age realization this week as I was looking this up. Anyway, it came from the movie Rocky III, and the problem that Rocky faced in this movie, and if you listen to the lyrics of the song, it specifies the problem that he had. He traded his passion for what? You know? For glory. Travis, you're all over it today. It's awesome. He traded his passion for the fight for glory. Rocky was facing a new normal, if you will. If you've seen the movies, you know that he was kind of the underdog. He had to work hard to get out on top of his boxing career. He had to dig deep. He had to take the hits. He went from being a nobody boxer from Philly to the heavyweight champion of the world. So he went from living in the bad neighborhoods, if you will, to living up in uptown society and such. So he's facing this new normal. And with the fame that came with his title came a new normal where Rocky, I mean, he lost his hunger. He lost his passion for what got him there in the first place. His strength was traded for a statue. And he faces in the movie a very hard and trying wake-up call. Now, I'm not a boxer, if you hadn't guessed that by now. But I'm very competitive when it comes to things like sports or games. I like a good contest, and yes, I like to win. Anybody else in the house kind of feel me on that? I don't play to get second place. When I play Monopoly, I loved it. There came a time when I would ask my sister, hey, you want to do Monopoly? And she's like, you already won. Okay, thank you. That's what I want to hear. But ruthless, right? I'd get into these games and try to do everything I could to win the game, and that came out in youth camps as well. I was instructed our kids. This is back when Cabin Cup was really a big thing. It was cabin on cabin, right? And our kids were pretty, I mean, they were pretty competitive, but then they really got to see how competitive their youth pastor was in those days. And I'll never forget one of the games. This is terrible. Don't forgive me, Lord, for even telling the story, I guess. But I'll never forget in one of the games, we were playing a group from Kansas City, and these kids had like 2 feet on our kids. I mean, there's Kansas City and then there's Garden City. I mean, we were this little crowd. And these guys, we were playing lacrosse, and it was we'll just say there were some things happening on the field that weren't supposed to be happening. And my guys are getting run over by these little guys. Now my guys may have been short, but they were pretty scrappy, right? And so one of my players, he's got dirt and grass stains all over him from getting knocked down. He yells back at me and he says, Pastor Chris, he says, what do we do? And I shout out to him. I said, you start playing their game. And the ref looks at me and goes, all right, wait a minute, don't encourage that. I said, when do you start calling this stuff? Well, this guy's name was Luke. I've talked about Luke before. And the ball is here on the ground and Luke and this other competitor are about the same distance from the ball and they're running full head at it. Luke has got a little bit of an advantage on this guy on speed, and he runs past the ball, and I realize, oh man, we're in trouble, because he wasn't looking at the ball, he's looking at the other player. And Luke gets his shoulder down low, and he hits this kid so hard in the gut, the kid flips up over the head, lands on his back, and our whole team is, yeah, you know, we ended the game right there. But competitive. I want to win. Probably one of the, I'm going to tell on myself. I'm not proud of these moments. We were playing volleyball. This was in Emporia, and I meant to get some pictures, and I failed to get those pictures to Jake. So I was going to actually have pictures of me up on the volleyball field in my prime, and really nothing has changed. Maybe a little bit bigger here. That's about it. Anyway, so volleyball, we're out there. They have a sand volleyball court at the Sonic, which was just awesome. You could have your milkshake and spike the ball all the same day. It was great. And so we'd go there on Sunday afternoons. We'd play our youth group. We were somewhat athletic. We were trying to get there. And another group shows up. You'd have to reserve it, and they were wanting to play. And I thought, hey, this is a great opportunity to get connected with these kids. They were a bunch of college students from Emporia State University there, and they asked if they could play us. Well, the first couple of games, we just got wasted, right? We are playing a team that's older than us, stronger than us, all this kind of stuff. And I took on the challenge. I was like, we are going to beat these guys one way or another. In one moment in my passion, this is terrible, forgive me, Lord. In one moment, one of our players was going for the ball. It was close to the net, and it lands in the sand real close to the pole. Now, one of my number one things that always got, can you see the passion already coming out? Is when the ball hits the ground unchallenged. In other words, when a person stands there and it just kind of lands, and it's like, well, that was yours. No, that was yours. How many know what I'm talking? Anybody? Okay, I've lost you already. That's okay. I'm going to tell my story, then we're going to get back to it. Here we go. So standing on the corner, the ball's coming, and it hits the ground, and I just kind of do like this motion, like, you know what just happened? They said, Pastor, if I would have gone for it, I might have hit the pole. And these words literally, there it is. Awesome. Anyway, these words literally came out of my mouth, and I had to retract them. I said, your body will heal, but we will never get that point back. And I was like, no, wrong, right? And then the guy across the field is like, I'm going to use that. And he was a gym coach at the high school. I said, don't, please don't. It's like, no, teaching the wrong word here. Competitive. I get into it. I like to win. I like to see those successes. We'd take on the challenges. And yes, we did end up finally beating this collegiate group of volleyball players on the Sonic battleground. This competitiveness went into other areas. We literally networked our house, physically wired our house for the original Xbox, when you could have 16 players at a time. And we would have the youth group over, and we would play these games, I mean, for hours, just developing relationships with these kids. Our kids were so into this, and my wife too. If you see her, you'll have to remind her of this stuff. But we would normally play upstairs on the bigger TV, because the youth pastor should have the bigger TV, right? But if Christy was getting beat, man, everybody in the house knew it, because she would start pounding on the floor, because a lot of the other sets were downstairs, and boom, 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 and the kids lived for that. It was hilarious. If they got Christy, if they knocked her out, then they knew they could hear it on the floor, right? And you'd hear them all start laughing, and Christy's, oh, you're competitive. Maybe a little bit. But all of these things that we used to do, and these things that I wish I could still do today, these were abilities that I didn't miraculously wake up with one day. None of these things came without practicing and strength training. Muscle strength, muscle memory, they were all part of what we did. And today we're going to be talking about strength training. And in a minute we're going to stop here, and to your surprise, as I've been talking and telling these stories, we've been having some ushers set up a mini gym in the fellowship hall. We're all going to work out this morning. Yeah. Not really. A couple of us are excited about it. I was kind of hoping to see a little bit of shock. You're like, yeah, whatever. We're going to go over there and eat is what we're going to do. Yeah. That's strength training, right? Mmm. Come on. There you go. But that's not the kind of strength that we're going to be talking about today. That's not the kind of ability that we're going to talk about today. The illustration talking about strength needed for competition, for these games, for these different contests, if you will, is not what we're going to talk about today. The kind of strength that we're going to talk about is the kind of strength that we need when we go into battle. The kind of strength that we need when we face a situation called spiritual warfare. When it comes to spiritual matters, church, we know such are not games. Hello? When it comes to spiritual situations, when it comes to these crossroads that we might meet, I want to move from this competitive fun type thing. We know that these moments are not games in life. We know that these matters are truly life and death situations. Amen. Spiritual matters are not mere competitions. The fight that we fight today is truly spiritual warfare, and it's a type of battle that takes strength beyond what a person can do physically. Make no mistake about it this morning, church. We face a very real enemy today. An enemy who does not want you stepping into the promises that God has for you. We believe this morning that God has amazing things ahead. Do we believe this morning? We must also believe that the enemy is going to try to do his best to do everything he can to keep you from experiencing God's best for your life. The enemy is going to bring resistance against you. A type of resistance, a formulated resistance, if you will cause you to want to stay or remain where you are instead of advance to take the new ground. But I want us to consider something this morning in light of this. Physically, what is needed or required in order for our muscles to become stronger and grow? Exercise? Resistance. Who said that? Awesome. Resistance. The resistance might come in the form of free weights, right? The resistance might come in the form of these, I've seen these elastic bands used, all these different things, maybe dumbbells, maybe it's distance for runners, etc. But my point is this morning is we only become stronger as we work through the resistance that is presented. Joshua is standing on the banks of the Jordan River. He had seen the promised land before. Remember, he was one of the 12 spies that had been sent in years before. And he had seen the resistance that they would face. And even in that day, church, he declared that they could go up and take the country. He knew that so long as God was with them, the battle had already been won. Amen. And now in this moment, he is leading a people who had just lost their leader. And God was calling him to go. God was calling him to cross that river. And as he did so, as God gave this call, God repeatedly encouraged Joshua with these words today. Hello. No. Be strong and courageous. Look at Joshua 1:6. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. Verse 7. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Verse 9, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do you think God is trying to get something through the mind of Joshua in this moment? We've talked about this before in teaching settings. When a teacher is giving a lecture or giving a lesson, one thing that I have always picked up on is if they write it on the board or it's something that they repeat, it might be something you want to take to heart. Why? Because it'll probably show up in a test down the road. Right? Or if the teacher literally tells you, you might want to write this down. You might want to write that down. It's a lesson he knows you're going to need. God is giving Joshua these words: be strong and courageous. Words given from God to Joshua as he faced the challenges that would be ahead of him. Joshua was being called to rise to this challenge, to live the life of a warrior, a life I believe God is calling all of us to live this morning. Church, we are not just called to survive. Our purpose is not to just take up space in this world. The Israelites were not destined to wander in the wilderness for all time. God had a plan. And for us today, God has a plan. But I want you to hear something today. Yesterday's strength will not be sufficient for where God is calling us to go. We need to find a new strength for the new normal that God is leading us to go into. And to be clear this morning, I'm not talking about a new normal that is just more of the same. Well, what do you mean by that, Pastor? How could you call it a new normal if it's more of the same? I'm not talking about becoming more domesticated by the world in which we control the thermostat and the ding of a new voicemail, text message, email, or tweet controls us. We're meant for more than that this morning, church. If our new normal is but superficial desire for more stuff, then we're missing the point completely. Did you hear me this morning? If our new normal is but superficial desire for more stuff, for more money, for more gadgets, or more followers, then we're missing the point. Our new normal is not found in anything of this world, church. It is found in the one who overcame this world. And reaching that new normal will require a strength like no other. A strength that can only come by following the one who calls us to go. And so I want to ask you this question this morning. Where do you find or where do you get your strength from today? This is not a sermon that is going to encourage you to grit your teeth, to try harder, to put in more hours, to get your hands more dirty, and to get ready for the life that you have always dreamed of. What I've come to learn is that's not how our walk with God works. That's not how spiritual life or spiritual warfare works. It's about God's work in you and through you today. It's not about necessarily your efforts or your planning or your abilities or your skills. Church, it's about surrendering to God, to the one who is able to do immeasurably more than we could ever ask for or imagine, according to whose power? His power that is at work within us. I've experienced victories in my life. I've experienced victories in ministry. And there's something that's interesting about these victories as I look back and I look at what God was doing in those situations. Those victories literally had nothing to do with me or my abilities. They had everything to do with God. And when I fully surrendered to what God was leading us to do, when I fully surrendered to what God was calling or leading my family to do, then and only then did we begin to experience the fullness of His presence moving us forward into the promises that He had ahead. But I can tell you, church, there's also been moments in my life where that full surrender wasn't there. And God maybe put something on my heart, and instead of trusting Him in the details, I had this great idea. I'll do it my way. I'll operate under my strength. I've got this, God. Great idea. Thanks for handing that to me. Now I'm going to run with it. Ever been there? Where God has laid something on your heart and you grabbed a hold of the plan, but then you begin to rewrite the script, if you will. Church, listen to me. We need to trust God. I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit. We need to trust God to handle the details. We need to trust God to do what needs to be done. And we simply need to obey what God has for us. John Lindell, in his book, New Normal, gives this amazing quote regarding the resistance to different things that we might face. Because oftentimes when I found myself in that position where I like to take, or I tried to take control, it was when resistance began to rise. Or when the questions began to rise. Questions like, okay, God, I see where you're calling me to go, but how is that going to happen? And I began to fill in the blanks. I began to to do the work that only God, or tried to do the work that only God could do. I began to try to face this fear on my own. And I love this quote, how he says this. John Lindell says this: feeling the fear doesn't necessarily mean that you are in the wrong place at the wrong time. It often means that you are on the precipice of the new land that God is calling you to enter. If it's something that we can handle on our own, there are days that I question such moves. Did that really come from God, or is that me? Because what I have learned in life, church, is that when God calls us to do something, it is almost always something that is bigger and beyond anything we can do on our own. And when I read Scripture, I see that same situation apply. So as we look at these things, as we look at these new normals, these new positions that God is placing us in and leading us to go into these new promises, it is not odd that we might look at that and feel a little bit anxious or feel a little bit worrisome as we do this comparison game between what we have and what it's going to take. But in that moment, I pray that we don't begin to question, am I in the wrong place or the wrong time? Because church, often it's when we're at that point where God is getting ready to do something amazing, if we continue to trust in Him. Amen. If we continue to step in faith according to His leading. So how do we find the strength that we need to cross the boundaries that might be before us? Well, the key is keeping our eyes on God. Stand on the call and keep your eyes on the one who is calling you. Joshua found strength not only in the words being spoken to him, Joshua found strength in the one who was speaking those words. Joshua knew that God, he was bigger than the resistance that he might face. God would give him the strength necessary to overcome. Church, the God that we serve today is bigger than the enemy who might try to stop you. Amen. We must learn to trust in His strength over our strength, and that is where the strength training begins. Number one, strength is found when we trust in God. And I've come to learn that the seasons that we walk through today, they serve to prepare us for the challenges that we might face tomorrow. How we finish today is often how we will begin in tomorrow's journey. I've never been much of the academic type. And I'm not trying to say anything against academia in any way, shape, or form. I believe in the importance of what can be learned in the classroom, but I've always been kind of a hands-on learner, experienced learner. Anybody else hands-on learner stay? Just curious, anybody else, the book, the academic side, you guys, that's what you prefer? This coming from a guy who's gone through graduate studies before only because God called me to go through those studies. But this is something I want to, a story I want to share with you today. I've always been a hands-on learner, so the thought years ago of attending a four-year Bible college was something that, I mean, honestly frightened me. Called into the ministry at 17, was very much so a learning believer. I didn't have the same kind of Bible background that my wife had, and I knew it. She wasn't my wife then. She was my girlfriend in those days. But I was always amazed at the Bible knowledge that she had, be it from missionettes, Impact Girls today, but missionettes, be it from Sunday school. The other big area where she learned a lot of the Scripture was from Bible quiz. How many remember that ministry from years back? And I remember being in awe in Sunday school or youth group or what have you at the knowledge that she could come up with in these moments. And then I'm thinking, man, I'm going to go to a Bible college and I'm going to go into this mode of training. And at that time, I maybe had four or five scriptures really committed to memory. I was very much a baby Christian, but I knew God had called me to go. I knew God had led me to go this direction. I ended up at CBC in Springfield. It was not my first choice. Somebody might say, well, that sounds kind of weird. I had my heart set to go down to SAGU, Southwestern Assemblies of God University, down in Texas. But the moment I stepped foot on CBC's campus, when we were doing a visit to that campus, I knew beyond the shadow of a doubt that's where God was calling us to go. God shifted gears, led me to go to CBC where I would be a full-time student while trying to work full-time to pay my college bill. I tried, I worked, I studied, I didn't sleep, I ate ramen noodles and SpaghettiOs, and to this day I can't hardly even look at the packaging. I still have, I don't know how in the world it has survived these 20 years since Bible college, but I still have my nasty Tupperware dish that I would take to Target with me every day that could hold a can of SpaghettiOs, a can of Dr. Pepper with the lid on it, still stained that SpaghettiO orange. I think it's time to retire that to a dog food bowl or something. I don't know. Oh. But I wrestled with the academic challenges as well as with challenges at home, things that were going on back in my home and in my extended family. I lost loved ones in that first semester. I almost lost it all financially. And in the driver's seat that entire semester was me, myself, and I. I tried to take that season on as I saw fit. And I've told you this story before. Eventually, I ran out of gas. Eventually, I found myself in a chapel service where I knew I was burning out, where I knew that my walk with God was nothing more than a superficial claim, because everything had become about the busy work. There was very little relationship. And it was in that fact right there that my soul began to starve for the strength only God could give me. And so I found myself in the altar at a Missions Emphasis chapel service. I was on my knees the entire service and then some. I was late to work that day, because I went to that altar saying to God, I am not leaving this place until my soul and my spirit has been renewed. And what was interesting in that prayer time is that renewal came the moment I surrendered all to God and said, God, I give it all to you. The moment I put me, myself, and I behind me and put God back in the driver's seat. Too often, church, we try to do what I just described. Too often we try to do things in our own strength, with our own understanding, with our own resources. We begin to compare the challenges that are ahead against the resources that we have in storage, if you will. We weigh the two against each other. Which is greater? And if we find the challenges ahead outweigh the resources in our hands, then often we stall out. And we surrender to going where God wants us to go, because we see what is ahead is too great. Listen to me. The enemy's going to try to do everything he can to try to get you into me mode. Amen. Come on. He's going to try to get you to shift into me mode as you stand at that precipice of the land that God is calling you to enter. The enemy is going to try to get you to reason your way out of following what the Lord is calling you to do. And what I find interesting in God's instruction to Joshua, not once did God tell Joshua to begin to reason. Not once did God tell Joshua to take inventory of his resources. God told Joshua to do what? To be strong and courageous. God promised Joshua that he would be with him the entire time. Church, we have to surrender. And that surrender is how we will experience the strength that we need from God in our lives. This surrender, it takes strength. Strength enough to move me out of the way and to place God in control of all things. That semester at CBC, my grades, they were not great. My family was still struggling. My job was stressful. My ability to balance everything that was going on in my first semester of Bible college was failing. I had substituted my personal walk with God with my studies. I was being educated, but I was not being refreshed. I was burning out. And in that moment, began to even question why God brought me to this place in the first place. And in that altar time, As God began to do a new work on me, aren't you glad that God has never finished, that God hasn't given up on us Amen. Yet, that he's still doing a new work in each and every one of us? Yes. God gave me two reminders in that moment. The first came in the form of scripture, a scripture that we all know well. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. This scripture, the context of this scripture, Paul declares that it's not his strength, or excuse me, Paul declares that his strength was not found in his circumstance. Rather, his strength was found only in Christ Jesus. In that passage, he says, you know what? I have learned how to live with much, and I have learned how to live with little. The circumstance of his situation, that's not where he found his strength. Where did he find his strength? Through Jesus Christ. By keeping his eyes on the Lord. And I would recite this verse as many times as needed when I tried to take over. God would remind me that it wasn't about what I could do. It was never about what I could do. And God would remind me to trust in him. And the second reminder came in the form of a song that I had learned at my home church back in Garden City, a song that was based off scripture. And it went like this. And if you know this song, I would encourage you to sing it with me today. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. Teach me, Lord, teach me, Lord, to wait. How many remember that? So obviously, more than half of y'all sang it with me. Teach me, Lord. Teach me, Lord, to wait. Other translations of this verse would say hope instead of wait, or place their trust instead of wait. But the idea is the same. Those who look to and trust in God will have their strength renewed. Not maybe. They will Amen. Have their strength renewed. Hallelujah. Not possibly. They will have their strength Hallelujah. Renewed. You see, here's a lesson that God taught me in that altar, and it's a lesson that I want to teach you. And don't take this the wrong way at first. You don't have what it takes to face the spiritual battles ahead on your own. If it was something that we could handle on our own, then what Jesus did on the cross was useless, was meaningless. Coming to that understanding is what might be keeping you from experiencing a breakthrough today. We have to realize we can't do this without God. Amen. And it has to be more than just a phrase that we use from time to time, or a place that we vacation to and then come back to our reality. Listen to me. We have to realize we cannot do this without God. Nor should we want to try to do this without God. For the addict, listen, the chains can only be broken by God's strength. For the broken, the healing can only come by God's hand. For the grieving, the comfort can only come from God's peace. For the hurting, God can turn your sorrow into dancing. For the confused or misguided, God will give you new purpose and direction. For the sin-ridden and hopeless, listen, redemption, forgiveness, and new hope can only be found in the Lord today. Church, we all face different challenges, but we all have the opportunity to call on God who can do all things today. But we will not step into that reality until we are willing to be honest and truthful with ourselves, with the statement that I just made: I cannot do this without God. We must be present or persistent as we reach for his promises. We must look to him. We must be willing to be consistent in placing our trust in him. Physical strength is obtained by working muscles over and over and over again while gradually increasing the resistance. Spiritually, we must be persistent, church. Our trust must be and will be exercised. And that trust will grow as God leads us on through the battles that are bigger than me, bigger than you, bigger than all of us, and so forth. But I want to remind us this morning, so long as we remain in Jesus, the battle, the victory has already been won. And when those battles arise, we need to look to that truth. When those battles arise, we need to stand in our faith. When those battles arise, our strength will be tested as we stand and resist the enemy, which brings us to point two very quickly this morning. Strength is tested as we resist the devil. And God has given us all that we need to stand against the enemy. Never forget, our enemy is not flesh and blood this morning. Even though sometimes, if we're honest, it sometimes feels like it. Ephesians 6 identifies the enemy. He says, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Our enemy has a name, and his name is Satan. And our enemy does not want you entering into the promises of God. He wants to keep you where you are. He wants to keep you from experiencing all that God has for you. The enemy is going to try to test your strength today. He might be testing it even now as we sit in this place today. He might choose to try to test it later. The question is, will you resist the enemy or give in to the attacks? Remember what I said about physical strength training a moment ago. In order for our strength to grow, resistance will be present. And resistance must increase for our strength to increase. Now, I don't wake up in the morning looking for a battle. Jim, I know for you, you wake up every morning, you're just, man, come on, bring on the battle today. Bob, I know you're same way, right, man? You're just, anybody in the room? When you woke up this morning, an hour less sleep, you're like, bring it on, I want the fight. No, I don't think any of us do. But here's the deal, church. We know that the battle is out there. We know that the enemy is not indifferent to your relationship with Jesus. He hates the fact that you know Jesus today. He is actively trying to come against you, but never forget the truth today that greater is he that is in you than he that is in this world. God will prevail. The battle has already been won. And as that resistance tries to increase, the enemy might try to get you to look to the right or to the left or even backwards because he doesn't want you moving forward in God. He doesn't want you crossing that river. And here's what he knows today. When a believer comes to the understanding that nothing is impossible for God, then that believer will become an unstoppable force for the kingdom of God. Satan does not want you finding strength in God today. So when the enemy attacks, when the enemy roars, we need to stand unmoved. And the strength that we find to take that stance can only come from God. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13 instructs us to put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, look at this next line, you will be able to do what? Stand your ground. And after have done everything, to stand. Church, I encourage you, I challenge you this morning, stand your ground. Pass the testing of your strength by trusting in God to get you through, because God will get you through. Do you believe that this morning? Do not allow fear or discouragement to rob you of strength, but allow his words of truth and promise to give you the hope and the assurance that you need to keep moving forward. Pastor Carly, if I could get your help on the keyboard this morning, I want to close with this reminder. Never forget, church, that the battle has already been won. God does not call his people to his promises and then abandon them on the way. God will lead, he will strengthen, and he will anoint every step we take. But those steps must be taken in faith and in trust in God. And there's one last reminder that I want to give us as we move to prayer and communion. One last resource, if you will, that I want you to keep in mind as you consider what God has ahead. And that resource is grace. God's amazing grace. I started this sermon with a song that most of the world can identify within the first few seconds. It's a song of strength, a song of competition, a song of courage, but it's a song that is lacking because it places all the emphasis on the person. The song that we're going to close with tonight and that's going to lead us into communion, it does the exact opposite. It's a song of salvation. It's a song of victory. It's a song of redemption. A song of breakthrough. It's a song that places all emphasis on our Lord and Savior. How many know today that God's grace is truly amazing? How many know today that God's grace is truly sufficient? When Paul was facing a situation in his life, he described it in Scripture as a thorn in his side, a messenger from Satan there to torment him. And in that moment, Jesus reminded him of how awesome his grace is. He says in 2 Corinthians 12, 9, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." And Paul goes on to say, "Therefore I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me." Friends, I pray that we never forget the power of Jesus Christ. I pray that we never forget the strength that is found in God's grace today. None of us would be here today without it. None of us were able to save ourselves from the spiritual situation we found ourselves in. It all came by way of God's grace. So you might find yourself on the riverbank, struggling to find the strength to take that first step. You know what God is calling you to do, but you have done the comparison game and church, the odds, well, according to the world's standards, the odds might be in favor of failure. But God is the master of beating those odds. According to the world's standards, church, none of us should be saved today. But here we are because of God's grace. He did for us what only he could do. He made a way where there seemed to be no way. We believe that for our salvation. Do we not? Come on. We believe that for our salvation. Only still, come on, half of us. We believe that for our salvation. God was able to make a way where there seemed to be no way. So don't question God as he is calling you to take another step into a new normal, as he is calling you into a new promise set before. Church, listen, he did it before. He's going to do it again. But we got to trust in him. Can we bow our heads, close our eyes all across this place? Maybe you find your trust wavering today. Maybe you find yourself in a position similar to where I was, burnt out, struggling, tired. You hear God calling. You hear God leading you. But you don't know if you have the strength to take that first step. God wants to renew your strength right now. But you got to surrender. You got to give it to him. Every head bowed, every eye closed. closed. No one's looking around. You'd say, Pastor, remember me in prayer, please. Raise your hand just right where you're at. Pastor, remember me. Praise God. Anybody else? Remember me. Amen. Amen. Anybody else today? Father, you see the hands this morning. More importantly, you know the heart. And I pray this morning in Jesus' name that you would begin to pour out a new strength right now as hearts are surrendered, as that realization sets in that we cannot do this without you. I pray this morning in Jesus' name that you would begin to do a work only you can do in each and every life. God, give them new strength today. Give them new hope today. Give them reassurance today. Give them peace today. And where the enemy might be trying to speak discouragement, where the enemy might be trying to convince them of defeat, I pray this morning that we would rebuke those words and that we would stand in the victory you have given us today. That we would stand in faith, knowing the battle has already been won. God, give us strength. Give us strength today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.